Hi, this is a football fans podcast from the people behind CelticUnderground.net. I'm Harry Brady and thanks once again for listening and downloading.
Some people might say my life is in a rut. I'm quite happy with what I've got. People might say that I should strive for more, but I'm so happy I can see the fine things happening here.
As many will be aware, this year is the 10th anniversary of the passing of the Celtic legend that is Mr. Tommy Burns, and the Celtic Graves Society will be having an event at Linn Cemetery on Saturday the 12th of May, the details of which are still to be confirmed. But if you want to go to the Celtic Graves website or go to their Twitter feed, you'll find more about it, and there'll be updates as we approach, because as I'm sure you'll appreciate, Saturday 12th of May will be the last game of the season, so that weekend will be the last game of the season. Saturday or the Sunday, one of those 2 days will be trophy day. It will no doubt be a 12 or a 12:30 kick-off with us getting the title in one of those 2 days. Anyway, with it being the 10th anniversary, young St Anthony of this parish caught up with Rosemary Burns to chat about various things, all things Tommy, and it's enough of me. And I'll pass you over to St Anthony, chatting to his neighbour.
Well, I don't give up this society, what's going underground. Well, it's the first best play, I've got to pound, going underground. So let the boys all sing, let the boys all shout for tomorrow. La, 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 la. It's my pleasure to speak to Rosemary Burns, Tommy's wife, and we're going to have a really nice chat about Tommy and talk about old times and how Tommy and Rosemary got together, and at the end we'll have a couple of wee reminiscences about stories in Tommy's life. So just to start off, Rosemary, were you a football fan as a young girl?
Yes, I was.
Did you go much in those days?
Me and my friend used to go in the years when you get lifted over the turnstiles. Occasionally, we never had the money to get in, so we used to go up and see if somebody would lift us over and that kind of thing. But yes, I did go, but when I was maybe 11, 12, you know, a bit of a tomboy then, and then I outgrew that, so.
Mm-hmm. And that begs the question then, where did you first come across Tommy, when and where did you first meet?
Well, I actually went out for my birthday. I can remember the date. My birthday's the 24th of June, and we met on the 28th of June. I was out with my friends for a night out for my birthday, and we were in a right classy place called the Terminal 1 in St. Ute Square, and I met him then, and that was it. So it went from there. That was in 1974.
And obviously that's before Tommy became a footballer, yes, famous, so he would just have been a normal teenager at the time.
Yes, I didn't even know he was a footballer. He never said he was a footballer. I never asked him what he did or whatever. He was only 17, so that never came up. He kind of cropped up, and then I found out what he did do. So, well, initially he couldn't come out on a Friday night. I just wondered why he can't come out on a Friday night. but then found out that what he did, so.
And were your family impressed when Tommy signed for Celtic?
Not at all. He'd signed for Celtic at that point. It was farmed out to Maryhill Juniors. No, they weren't impressed at all. No, they were big Celtic fans, but obviously they'd rather have the best for me, if you know what I mean. They loved him. You know what I mean? They did love him, but it wasn't a, oh my goodness, you're going to be a Celtic player. Nothing like that. They weren't impressionable like that at all.
So they loved him more because he was Tommy rather than because he was Tommy the Celtic?
Yes, they loved the person.
Now, I saw his full debut against Aberdeen in 1976, and there's two things I'll never forget from that day, even as a boy. Number one is the thick mop of red hair stood out a mile, and the second thing is, in the early days, is how thin he was.
Yeah.
So, I mean, at that time, that must have been quite exciting, but when he was breaking into the team and just beginning to make a name for himself.
I think so, yeah. I mean, he worked hard for it. You know what I mean? He did everything right, and I mean, he was very thin, slim, but used to call him the thin man. But obviously built himself up and, you know, into the gym. I think at that time, big joke, he'd say certain things to him to do and things like that. So he did everything by the book. He was just desperate to have the career there, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So
it's quite funny because I remember that not long after that, about two or three games, he played against Rangers, and he was a lot of guys made him man of the match.
And I think that there was a nice story years ago I remember reading about his mammy brought him breakfast in bed and he was reading the newspapers. That again must have been an exciting thing.
I think so, yeah. She kept all his clippings, actually. She was... But Thomas's mother wasn't into football at all. She wasn't interested. I don't think she never saw him play. I don't think she ever. I think she went to his testimonial game, and that's about her. She'd never went to football at all. Mm-hmm. Never saw him play.
It's funny to think these days of an actual Celtic first team player staying in the vicinity of Parkhead. I mean, where would Tommy lived at that point?
Soho Street.
So he's you know, 5
walking
minutes
walk
for Celtic Park.
Yeah.
These days, you know, it's unlikely that. You would get a Celtic player so near to the ground, you know, in the area surrounding Parkhead. Uh-huh. But there's a story that one of the players told me once about he wasn't a great timekeeper in terms of training.
He wasn't a great timekeeper in terms of anything.
Well, Davy Proven and Mick Conroy would be coming for Inverclyde, and they would be going along the Gallagher, and Tommy would literally be running to be in time for training. And Davy Proven says to him, "You know, Tommy," says, "if I'm passing you by," he says, "I'll just stop in at the close and come and get you, save your run." And he says, "That was the worst thing I've done." He says, "Because rather than one guy getting fined, that was the three of them getting fined." Because Tommy always held them back.
Well, he had a car that never started. I mean, he did have a car, but he never started. So, So that was him. Yeah, he was always late for everything. Always.
So, in plain terms, 1980 was a big year for Tommy. And his career, Celtic career, was probably at the crossroads, because a few important things happened in 1980, of which you'll be more than aware. The first one is that you and Tommy get married in St Francis in the Gorbals.
That's right.
So I always remember there was a 40 in the Daily Record, and I've never seen so many people outside the church.
I know, I could have been burst into tears. I came at your special day and they had to close the doors, and then when they opened the doors and I saw these tricolours hanging over the masonettes and Cumberland Street, I could have cried, and we were all singing Hail Hail, and do you know what I mean? My day was ruined.
Because the photos, the wee boys climbing up trees and hanging off walls and all that kind of thing.
That's
just
right.
To get a glimpse of Tommy coming out of the chapel.
I know, no me, just him. So. And the funny thing, one of my uncles had a beard, and just shows you what the kids don't know. I mean, they're maybe only 7 or 8, they're running up to him and asking for his autograph. They thought he was Danny McGrain. The police let the players all go a side door kind of thing, and so none of them came out with us, you know what I mean? So that kind of took the pressure off a wee bit as well.
So that's Tommy married, and that summer, people might not remember this, but Tommy was the first Celtic player who had freedom of contract, as in his contract was up and he could have moved on, because that rule just came in that summer. It was actually Tommy and Roddy McDonald were the two
rebels, Big Billy called them.
Exactly. Now, what I'm going to say is, at the time in the papers, there was rumours that Liam Brady just went to Juventus, and Arsenal were looking for a left-sided midfield player. Tommy fitted the bill. There was rumours. Were you aware of that at the time?
Yeah, we were getting contact from the manager. I think his name was Terry O'Neill, would that be
Terry O'Neill, yeah.
Right, yeah. No, that was a goer.
So there was a chance that after a couple of weeks... married, you might have been away to London.
Yeah, well, he would have been away to London, I'd have said. But what happened then was Big Billy was just forcing him out, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And the horrible thing about it was, at that time, players were going for maybe, at the most, £400,000, and that was a record-breaking fee, and Big Billy put £1 million tag on his head and all that, and, you know, I suppose that's what managers do, but... So he was kind of forcing his hand a wee bit, so he eventually just signed, and that was it.
I remember seeing Tommy roughly about 1980. He came down to St Anthony's Juniors in Govan, and the reason he came was Jimmy Johnson had been junior with Blantyre Celtic, and the Ants would normally get a couple of dozen at a game. In this one, probably they get maybe about 1,000 people, which was quite unusual. And I remember seeing Tommy, he had a big long leather jacket, and he had green shoes. I'd never seen a guy in my life with green shoes. Do you remember that?
Well, you liked his style. Well, they were a kind of turquoise, because I remember we were out on a Saturday night and came in, and my sister just looked at his shoes and she started to sing Blue Thread Shoes to him. His face was mortified.
Tommy's maybe at the crossroads, but he did sign the contract, and that's when his best years as a player were about to unfold. I'd say between 1980 and 1983, he was really at his peak. And I remember one time, around about 1980, my dad went down to work the shipbuilders in Liverpool. So he only came back up the road every fortnight or every 3 weeks. And obviously me and him would go to the games. Now Charlie Nicholas had just broke into the team. And he was having a ridiculous record. He scored something like 15 goals in 10 games. Everybody was talking about him. And I was desperate for my dad to see Charlie Nicholas for the first time. So we went to this game. But after the game, my dad wasn't that impressed with Charlie. But my dad loved Tommy Burns. But he used to get a wee bit frustrated with Tommy because Tommy would try and beat an extra man. Or he wouldn't lead a ball off at the right time. And then all of a sudden, maturity in his game. This is Tommy at his best. And I always remember my dad saying, that's fantastic, he's the player now that we always hoped that he was going to be. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if you could put that down to, you know, getting married or fatherhood. Or,
I think so. I mean, I think what at a time he said, I mean, I've always been from the south side of Glasgow, always. And when we were getting married, we hadn't even really started looking for a house. And I thought, never think we could afford Newton Mearns at all. This hasn't always been my house. We'd had a house before mm-hmm. this, but thinking, Shawlands maybe in the south side. But I thought about a few months to go to Denison or whatever. I couldn't live in East End. And I said this to him after we were married. I said, I was terrified. He said, no. He says, I was inviting pals at my door every night and whatever. He says, I was quite happy to get away from it. And I think, yes, that did help a lot, that, you know, he could come home and switch off and there was no, you know, the constant people at your door or the pals. Yes, mm-hmm. You know.
Mm-hmm. So, 1982, Celtic won the league for the second year in a row. Tommy's best midfielder in the country, and then Jock Stein picked his squad for the World Cup finals. Now, I remember how dreadful I felt when he didn't get picked for the 22. If I was a crazy situation, Jock made a mistake because he picked 24 and he whittled it down to 22, which means two guys were going to lose out. He should never have done that. He should just have held his counsel and just chosen the 22. And I know for reading his book and interviews, that was a desperately sad time for him.
It was. He was gutted. He was absolutely gutted about that because he'd had a good season at Celtic. And basically, he just couldn't believe it. I think it was him and
Ray Stewart.
Did he play for West Ham at
yes,
the time?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Aye, him and Ray Stewart. Thomas just left his suit on the team suit on the bus and just walked off. But Big Billy was great because Big Billy phoned the next morning. He was the manager at the mm-hmm. time at Celtic, and he was absolutely shocked. And he was a good support to him and talked him through. He said, you know, we all get these disappointments, he says, but you just bounce back from them, and which you did. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you just it's like a defeat. You know, you think that's the end of the world, and then you win the next game and you're away again. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? So, but I don't think he got as many caps as he wanted, to be honest with you.
No, I should have had more.
But anyway, still got them, so.
I actually think Jock Stein didn't want to be shown preference mm-hmm. to Celtic players. Now, there was only two Celtic players in the squad. I might have understood it if it was five or six.
Uh-huh.
But I mean, there was four Aberdeen players in that squad, there was three Dundee United, so,
uh-huh.
you know, I think Tommy definitely got a raw deal.
But was Aberdeen, you know, the kind of team that was flying at that point?
But we were winning leagues. You know, arguably we were still that season anyway, but uh-huh. we were better than them, which sort of led to the sense of disappointment. So, you know, Tommy brought a book out in 1988, and he says that the players at that time were paid particularly well. Like, for example, I don't think you would have described yourself in those days as a wag, in terms of the way that the girls do now, and their fancy lifestyles mm-hmm. and all the rest of the stuff. I mean, players in the days had humility and they came from a working class background and they earned a wee bit more than the average guy.
That's right.
And I remember my dad calculating, actually, like, I can't remember the figure in Tommy's book, I mean, it might have been like maybe £300, £400 a week. And my dad calculated that he wasn't really earning much more than the supporters at that point.
Uh-huh.
So I don't think the fans these days would appreciate just how normal a lifestyle that the players led then.
Well, they were just normal boys doing a job, and that was it. And they married normal women who just became mums and wives. There was no, wasn't any great flash around with that.
You weren't getting on the front page of any magazines, no?
No, unfortunately. Well, fortunately, no.
Like, I remember talking to Frank McGarvey and Mick Conroy, and Mick Conroy said that what made Celtic bearable was that you get bonuses. Obviously, if you won, you get a bonus at the end of the season. But his point was, these were the contractual bonuses, and you were at the mercy of the directors how much you got.
Nice.
And you know, he says, actually, the members queuing up in the secretary's office at Celtic Park, all the players in a row, to
see
what they were getting for this bonus, and then talking about it after it. And then Frank McGarvey makes the point in 1985, when he scored the famous goal that won the cup final. They had a night out that night, and all the wives were making a big fuss of Frank, and Frank says, I know why. He says, because two or three of them had said, that's what, we can have a good holiday now, because you can rely on the bonus money to go somewhere in holiday. So it wasn't a glamorous lifestyle. Yeah. And they weren't,
you had to get your bonus to go your summer holiday, basically. That was it, or to pay your bills. But you did get a bonus there. I don't know if they do that now. You did get a bonus for winning.
Mm-hmm.
And drawing, mm-hmm. Just say at the time it was £20 a point or yeah, whatever. Mm-hmm. So if you won, you were maybe going to get £40. I don't even know what it was, but just that's a figure. So you did get, I don't know if they do that now, but now I now know that they do, for talks that if you win the league, you'll get 10% of your salary and mm-hmm. all that kind of thing. So there is a percentage on it now, whereas mm-hmm. it was up to Desmond White.
That's right, that was the point they were making, is you couldn't rely on it because you didn't know how much. Number one, you weren't sure if you were going to win it in the days. Number two, you didn't know how much you were going to get. And uh-huh. as they say, Mick and Frank were saying that it was quite generous. Uh-huh. But at the same time, you couldn't bank on it.
Uh-huh.
Very good. There was a lovely story about, as well, about how, I think, I'm sure I read this in the papers once, that you were going on holiday and Tommy wanted to borrow Paddy's credit card, but he didn't quite understand why.
No, what had happened was we were going to Florida. The kids were all tiny.
Mm-hmm.
Jordan was just a baby and we didn't have credit cards at that time, so, and anybody you spoke to, and it's true, when you go to America now, America at all, you need a credit card. Mm-hmm. At any hotel now you need a credit card to hand over. And I says to him when he came in that night, I said, Thomas, everybody says you need a credit. He said, don't worry about it, Henry. He says, I'll get a loan of big packies. So I said, okay, just take it, that's absolutely fine.
There's something naive about that, but it's nice, you know what I mean, because obviously, as I was saying there, that compared to these days, where they've all got big fancy houses and they don't have any connection with the supporters and they're just living on a different planet.
Yeah, know? I know.
So that was a close-knit Celtic team at that point. Who was Tommy friendly with, and which other wives?
They were all friends. All the boys used to get into a pub called Archie's on a Saturday night after the game. Thomas would always come home, and the wives always went in and met them. Thomas would always come home and get, well, I didn't drive at the time anyway. Mm. So he'd always come home and get me, and if we went in, we didn't go in every Saturday night. But they were all friends, they were all good, everybody got in together. There was no there was no dislike between any of them. You know what I mean? Nobody, maybe there'd be arguments on the pitch about different things, about, you know, passes and things like that, but we were friendly with Big Packy, Doyley at that time, very friendly with Doyley as well. But they were all good friends. They were all good friends. A lot of the boys didn't have wives. A lot of them weren't married. Davey wasn't married at that time. Michael wasn't married. But a few of them weren't married at that time. So basically, the married ones just more or less went out together. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. It was quite a likeable team in the days. You know, it was like, without being funny, it was a team that I sort of grew up as a teenager and you know, I can't think of any players that I disliked. They seem to have a understand what Celtic was about and have a real passion for it.
Uh-huh, yeah. Yeah, I would agree with that. Mm-hmm.
So, Tommy was recognisable everywhere he went. And in terms of being, you know, yourself and maybe even when the kids were growing up, was that sometimes a burden when you went places, or could it be a bit of a nuisance?
No, not really. Obviously, it was his part of the job, you know what I mean? I mean, they would depress you, they would come over for an autograph or something. It wasn't as if they wanted to sit with you all night, and you know what I mean? Nothing like that. So, and obviously, they were the people who were paying my wages, so you can't really turn your nose up at them, you know what I mean? So, no, not at all.
And Tommy got a testimonial in 1987.
That's right.
So, that must have been a really, you know, a memorable day for him, and as a family as well, it must have been quite
Yeah, it was. It was lovely. Michael was only born. He was born on the 1st of July. I think it was in August sometime, so he was only about 5 or 6 weeks old. So the two girls and I went, and Thomas's mum and dad were there, and I think it was against Liverpool.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great turnout and everything. It was really good. And then we went down to a place called Gledock House after it for the dinner. And that was lovely as well. We had a good committee and everything at the time. So, yeah, that was a special day.
It was a beautiful sunny day as well. It was ideal.
Yeah, but so didn't start off a sunny day, to be honest. We were up early in the morning, obviously, get the kids all ready. And cloudy, and I thought, oh God. But anyway, just about back at 9 o'clock in the morning, the sun, I said, oh, the sun's coming out, and it was a really hot day. It was a lovely day.
And then Kenny
Dalglish
coming back as well, I think, with the mental.
Yeah, and then I think they had just signed Peter Beardsley and John Barnes. Yeah, I think they had just signed him, so that was another attraction as well, these two great players, you know what I mean? So
and Tommy did a gesture that day that I think everybody always appreciated as well. Danny was let go in the summer, and he didn't get a chance to say farewell. And Tommy, being Tommy, invited Danny to come out, and at half time, Danny got the reception that he should have got in terms of. The fans letting Danny know what he meant to him.
Danny was a wee bit, I think, unfairly treated there. I don't mean everybody's got to leave, but normally you get to see your Cheerios to the fans, you know what I mean? So I felt rotten about Danny for that. But he got to do it that day anyway, so.
And then that started off the centenary year, which was wonderful. You know, and they ended up in the League and Cup double, and
yeah, Big Billy had just come back that year.
Billy came back in the summer, and you know, the things going right away. You know, sometimes it takes a few games, but the Celtic get right into it, and you know, for Tommy to be part of the centenary year, I think would have meant a great deal to him.
Oh God, I mean, he always says that obviously centenary year is going to be part of Celtic history.
Yeah.
And he's on that team sheet as part of Celtic history, so that was always, that meant a lot to him.
Another thing at the end of the season as well is I think it was tickled that he got to play at Wembley for Scotland. Yeah. I mean, he didn't get very many caps, but you know, a lot of Scots guys have got the ambition to play at Wembley, and he managed to get that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, he was pleased about that. I forgot about that actually. Yeah, he was pleased about that as well. Yeah.
Did you go down?
No.
And you were saying that he didn't go to many games in the days?
No, in the beginning of his career. No, definitely not. Maybe just the start of the centenary year, went more. The kids were getting older and things like that, and maybe wanted to go. And then when we went, as I say, when we went to Kilmarnock, went to every single game, home and away. So.
So in 1989, it was the end of the road for Tommy at Celtic. No, nothing lasts forever, and it was his last game against Ajax. Now those of us who were there that night, and that was a bitter cold night. It was a freezing, horrible cold night. He threw his boots into the jungle and he got took off for the last time. And it was emotional, but I mean, as a family, if it was emotional for the fans, do you recall that as an emotional?
Oh my God, it was awful. It was really just. I mean, I was upset. He was okay, but he said he'd done all his crying in the pitch when he was out warming up, thinking this is the last time I'm going to play here. But Big Billy made a mistake. Billy, he came out and admitted it. Not so much letting Thomas go, but basically, Matt McGee left that year. Big Roy left that year, so basically he was without any experienced players at all, you know what I mean? So, but anyway, nothing lasts forever.
I always remember feeling sad that night because for my age group, the three players that always bracketed together was Tommy, Roy Aitken and George McCluskey, because they all broke through at the same time. And Tommy was probably the first player that I remembered the beginning of his career, and I saw the end of his career. You know, and you know, I sort of grew up with him, and that was a weird feeling that he wouldn't be there any longer.
Yeah.
Hard to get used to.
Well, that was the way we felt as well. That was the way we felt, the exact same. That, you know, I mean, he used to joke that the car could take itself into Celtic Park every day. You know what I mean? He didn't need to drive it; he just knew the road. And but he had a. He had a fantastic time there and loved every minute and would never have changed it for a thing, you know what I mean? I don't think even the Arsenal thing, as much as I think at that time, all right, Arsenal, but I think it was more money as well, you know what I mean? Thinking, well, I could be on £100 here, I could get £300 down there, something like that, but it never happened, and I think he was quite happy it never happened.
So he moved to Kilmarnock, as we all know, and it was a good move for him. I understand that the Kilmarnock people were good people.
Oh,
there in the club.
They were absolutely amazing. The Fleetons, and Bob Fleeton had contacted him. No, Jim Fleeton had contacted him. Bob owned the club. Bob lived in America, and he owned the club. And Jim Fleeton contacted him, thinking a long shot, but we'll try it anyway. And Tom said, "I'd love to come and play for you." So he said, "I don't want to go and play with Hibs and play against Celtic and all that kind of thing." So at that time, it was just too raw. So he took up that challenge, and it was a challenge because, I mean, he said he saw more cows and sheep in his whole life because they were going to all these places like Brecon and all this kind of thing. And but they were fantastic. They were great people. They really were.
And they say things happen for a reason as well. So not long after getting there, he gets to become player manager.
And that's right.
It must be a concern for a professional when you're looking to the future and you're thinking, well, I need to make a living here.
Uh-huh.
And going into coaching and then management, Kilmarnock was a good grounding for him.
It was. And, you know, there's a great wee group of fans at that time. And obviously Billy was there and he was assistant manager, but he was a player as well. George McCluskey, who was an amazing signing. Bobby Williamson, you know, signed a lot of good players, a lot of professionals, a lot of older players that just knew what they were doing, which kind of set the grounding for all the young ones as well. So, no, that was they were good times, actually. They were very good times. They were a right family club, you know what I mean?
So, in terms of Tommy becoming a manager, looking to the future, was it something he always intended to do that you maybe discussed and that was one of his way forward in life, or did it, was it just an opportunity?
Basically, it was a foregone conclusion, to be honest with you. I never ever thought he was not going to ever be in football, you know what I mean? So I never ever expected Thomas not to be in football. I suppose we did think he was going to be a manager someday.
Mm-hmm. Now, he was successful at Kilmarnock. He took Kilmarnock through the divisions. He got him established in the SPL, and he was creating a name for himself as an up-and-coming manager. And of course, Fergus McCann takes over, Lou McCarry gets sacked. And the next thing, the papers are saying Tommy's going to be the next Celtic manager. But sadly, looking back, it was quite acrimonious, which is a shame, because it didn't go smoothly, did it, the move to Celtic?
No, it did not. We were actually on holiday and when the call came. So he headed home and I just stayed on holiday with the kids. And Fergus was a hard man to deal with.
I'm going to come on to that in a wee minute,
actually. Aye, Kilmarnock could always put up barriers and things like that, you know what I mean? Which obviously was always going to happen, you know what I mean? So, he actually went down to say his cheerios to Kilmarnock and he came back up. He hadn't signed anything at Celtic. Mm-hmm. And he came back up and he had tears streaming down his face. And I said, is that kind of leave the people? He says, they appreciate me so much, he says, and they're such good people. So we sat and spoke about it, and I says, well, you do whatever you want to do. I says, but this chance will never come again. He said, no. So ended up at Celtic, and that was the decision he made.
God, that's a real dilemma, because that ideally, in a perfect world, you'd have stayed a wee bit longer with Kilmarnock, maybe won a trophy with him, and then moved on to Celtic when the time was right.
Yeah, he was only 37 when he went to Celtic. He was still playing for Kilmarnock.
He was very young, and I think looking back, it's hard to believe now Celtic were in a terrible state. I mean, Tommy was the first guy that went in and grabbed Celtic with the scruff of the neck.
Uh-huh.
You know, whereas before that, we were in a terrible state.
Uh-huh.
You know, with managers and players and, you know, the stadium
was
going to bits, the debt, you know, it's easy to forget how bad things were.
I know. We're nearly shutting the doors, I think, at that point.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So you talked there about Fergus. I was going to bring on to that now. Tommy was 3 years as a manager under Fergus, and what I've got written down here is Fergus is loved by the Celtic fans, but he couldn't even an easy guy to work with things.
No, I think he was an impossible man to work with, to be honest with you. But don't get me wrong, he came with an agenda, he came with a plan, he carried out his plan to the very letter and went away, and that was it. But it was impossible to work with. I mean, I think if you look at when Thomas left, Wim Janssen took over, won the league, but he still left.
I know.
Couldn't handle Fergus, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So
I think something like Jock Brown might help Tommy at the time, because when it was just Tommy and Fergus, you know, they were a clash of personalities, if you like. But somebody in the middle might have been a good thing.
Yeah. It was just, I mean, even the David Ginola, we thought we had David Ginola, and he said, I want to go home and bring my wife over, and before he left, Fergus says to him, well, have you ever been to Falkirk on a frozen December night and all this? So, and then get a phone call the next day, he was going to, he chose Newcastle. Mm-hmm. So Fergus more or less put
put them off.
Put the hampers and that, aye.
That's a lot of saying he'd have been, that made a big difference.
Yeah.
It shows you the ambition of Celtic at the time, which is a good thing, because it was a time of great change. A new stadium, foreign players, there was big crowds, and Rangers were going for 9 in a row. But adding all that together, Tommy must have been under some pressure that maybe the fans didn't appreciate.
Well, he was, but you know, he never brought it into this house, not once, never brought anything into the house, even as a player, as a defeat, never came in a bad mood, came in, maybe go on the phone and speak to one of the teammates or whatever, but never brought it up in the house and never sat with a sullen face or anything like that. It was good that way, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It really was good that way, but yeah, he was under a lot of pressure. His hair went for the degree within 2 years.
As I said earlier on, the bright red mop of hair, you know, it wasn't there then.
I know.
So that is maybe an indication of how inside things were hard.
Yeah.
So when the time came to leave Celtic, you know, at the end of the 96-97 season, you know, it's a difficult time because, as I said, Rangers got the 9 in a row. Celtic fans are upset because they're not winning, but leaving, how badly did that affect them?
Well, he came in here, we knew it was happening. Mm. Anyway, the writing was on the wall. We hadn't been told, but it's just his contract was up and there was nothing else on the table, so we knew that was going to be happening. And he came in and he got a phone call to go back in. So he went back in. By that time, the phone was ringing off the hook, so somebody must have got something leak. And then he just phoned, he says, that's it, I've been sacked. I says, right, okay. But the press were all outside this house, or in that street. My Jordan was out kicking the ball about with him. He was only a wee tot, so he was out kicking the ball about with him. So, and I says, what do I do? I can't get out of the house. I says, they're all here. And he says, just get the kids into the car. He says, if they don't follow you, he says, go out to Big Parkies and I'll meet you there. So we stayed in Parkies till about 11 o'clock that night, and we came down that took the road and they were still all there. So basically we drove past and I get the car, he was driving and I get the car. I tell a lie, the two of us were driving, I had my car and he'd his car. So he drove down to the street behind and I just get the kids out of the car and came in. And there's a wall there, he can come over, he just come over the back way and then that was it. So
it's terrible you go to there, aren't you, then, house?
We just shut all our curtains and everything, so they eventually disappeared, so.
That must have been a hard time then.
It was, you know, it's, we even going over the next morning for the Rose, his face is on the paper and headlines and everybody knows who you are and it's, but I wasn't say I was embarrassing because I was very proud of him, you know what I mean? But
well, it's not to be embarrassing.
No.
Every manager gets the
sack. But yeah, of course, it's part of the job.
That's it.
It's just everybody's staring at you, you know what I mean? As if waiting on the reaction from you.
As if you're going to bust out greet.
Exactly, aye. So
after Celtic, you went to Reading. Now, I know from what I've read again that wasn't an easy time because I think you alluded to earlier on there that you didn't want to go to London, you probably didn't want to go to Reading.
No, well, initially he went to Newcastle.
Oh, right, for McKennie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He went to Newcastle to coach McKennie. And I was going down to Newcastle. My oldest daughter was Emma, she was doing her sixth year, so she couldn't come with us. She was doing her fifth year, she couldn't come with us. And so I went down and looked at schools and things like that, and I said, you know what, this is commutable. Not every day, you know what I mean? But I could drive down on the weekend and stay overnight. It's only a 2.5-hour drive. And that's what we decided on. And then the Reading job came up, and that wasn't commutable. So we all had to go apart from Emma. She was in her sixth year at this point. So she stayed behind, and we all went down. It was hard. That was really hard. Yeah. I absolutely hated it. And so did Michael, just cried every single day. They all did at the time, but you know what, he was too, not saying too experienced the job, but he didn't know that league. You know, he was more used to working with better players, if you know what I mean. So basically he was signing, I think he made about, I don't know, about 6 or 8 on the deadline day, and it was all Jim McIntyre, Robert Fleck,
a lot of Scottish guys,
but just in them, a lot of them, Robert Fleck got injured right away, so he was out, and but no, they were different, you know what I mean, it was just a different place altogether. We rented a lovely house, and it was a beautiful place, I mean, where we lived, it was really lovely, and the kids didn't settle in at school very well, initially, and then when it came time to leave, they were loving it. They were loving it. They'd made friends. I think we were there for about 18 months. So they had made, well, Thomas were there for about 2 years. He had been about 6 months before us. The last 6 months, the last thing of the season. We didn't get down to the August. It was ready to start. But then they'd settled, and then they didn't want to come, well, apart from Jonathan, but the rest of Jenna and Michael had settled. And they didn't want to come back up the road then. So, but anyway. So as well, we had to come. And the thing is, well, I don't know, we didn't sell this house, and maybe that was a pull that I kept having. Maybe if I'd have sold the house, I'd have settled better.
Yeah.
Because I knew this was here to come home, I just wanted to come home. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So maybe if I'd sold the house, I'd have thought, right, this is my life then now, and just made a go of it, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
And of course, Brendan Rogers, was it Reading?
He was in the academy, yes.
Tommy started him out in youth development, which was the first small step to Brendan being where he is now. So, do you remember Brendan at the time?
I don't. But I do, actually, because his mother-in-law and his father-in-law at the time, Mike and Grace Kearney, they had quite a lot to do with the club, and they had four daughters, or five daughters. So, yeah, I knew them, and he was with... Brendan was with one of their daughters, kind of thing, at the time. And so I knew him through that, not through the football, but but Thomas saw a lot of potential in Brendan, because I think he was part-time at the time when we went, and he took him on full-time. Mm-hmm. And
I think he's always been, in interviews, he's always been grateful for Tommy's help in the early days, the very early days.
Yeah, aye.
And have you met Brendan since?
A couple of the, well... When the day I went in, they asked me to unfurl the flag. I met him then, and I've met him at a couple of functions and things, so...
So, I know it didn't work out at Reading, but as I say, everything's for a reason. And then Tommy got brought back to be coach under Kenny
at
Celtic, so... Mm-hmm. Well, you must have been ecstatic, even just coming home.
Yeah, we were absolutely delighted. I remember getting the call. Peter Grant, Thomas had signed Peter Grant, and he was staying with us at the time. His wife was still down in Norwich, I think it was, so he was staying with us at the time, and obviously he didn't know his way about, and he needed to find a bank, and I said, I'll come with you. So the Chews was in the city centre, and he's kind of dealing, and he got a phone call, and he went, I need to take this Rosemary outside, and he came back in, and it was for John Majeski. Mm-hmm. And John Majeski was never there.
He was the chairman of the club, wasn't
he? I think he'd that auto parts, I think that was his business. But he was always in Kuala Lumpur, that's where he kind of lived at the time. So anyway, Peter came in and he put his hand in my shoulder, and he said, that's it, Rosemary. He says, Tam and Parky have been sacked. And I went, yes. I says, right, let's go to Marks and Spencer's and get something nice for the dinner. I says, let's go. We are just delighted to get back up the road, you know what I mean? So...
And then coming back to Celtic, if they come back to any Scottish club, it would have been a bonus, but to come back to, to Parkhead must have been a great deal in.
Yeah, I know, but that wasn't going well either for John Barnes, you know what I mean? And then I think they'd asked Kenny to take the manager job, but Kenny just wouldn't do it. Just wasn't for it at the time. So, and he'd have kept Thomas on, but then I don't know who they brought in at that time then.
Martin O'Neill was one after Kenny.
Was it? Mm-hmm. Well, Martin O'Neill then.
Martin kept him on, and then Gordon Sutton came after Martin O'Neill.
Oh, Gordon was great.
Because I've got it down here actually that it's weird how close Tommy and Gordon became, because they're on the part that
they were right
bumps at one another, and the two of them had the red hair, the two of them had tempers. And Tommy in his elder days at Celtic was seen as something else. The elder statesman, the gentleman of the team, but I remember Tommy being younger, and obviously you'll know better than me. Tommy had a bad disciplinary record. They used to get sent off two, maybe times a season, because the red mist would descend. And the younger days in particular, he was quite aggressive on the pitch. And
I think
he
what
wasn't
happened
for turning another cheek.
I think up at Aberdeen when he got sent off, I think it was his first game back after a long injury, and I can't remember what happened between him and Gordon, but. It happened and he got sent off, and I think he was absolutely furious at that, you know. Mm-hmm. Don't get me wrong, he didn't like getting sent off, he hated himself when it happened, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So,
it shows you how guys mature, because he became that sort of respected elder statesman that never get into trouble and was a gentleman and stuff like that. Because, uh-huh, as I said, him and me Gordon, I remember that day at Aberdeen, he nearly huffed Gordon too.
Mm-hmm.
So he did, it was a terrible tackle, I don't know what possessed him. But again, it's funny to think how the two of them became such close friends.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they did. But that's the thing, that the man on the park was never the man in the house, if you know what I mean. Just, so.
But there's a lovely bit of footage that you see that I really like. It's the night we beat Spartak Moscow on penalties. And Arthur Boric saves a penalty and Celtic go through. And as Boric is running away, the players catch up and they'll pile into opium. And the last one to pile on at the end was Tommy.
He was like Superman.
You know, what a jump.
Flying right, through there.
Right, and that's. And Wee Gordon was in there as well. That's a lovely memory.
Uh-huh.
So as the two of them together.
Yeah.
And I think Tommy must have helped Gordon, because Gordon really didn't have a Celtic link. It couldn't have been easy for him to come in as a manager. And I think Tommy being there helped get him credibility in the eyes of the fans.
Well, obviously, Gordon had been away in England and all that for a lot of years. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So coming to Glasgow was just a culture shock to Gordon. And yeah, you're right. The fans never really took to him at first. Whether they ever took to him or whatever, I really don't know. But Thomas helped him. He says if it wouldn't have been for Thomas, he'd have been off his head, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, Tommy's obviously experienced it before, knows the pitfalls, the pressures, and he'd have been a great counsel for
yeah,
for
he was. But, see, Gordon, like I said, see, Thomas would spend his whole day in the Celtic Park. Gordon would do his training and do what he to do and deal with the press and whatever else, then go home to Wesley and the two of them would go out for lunch or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. Thomas never came home about 9 o'clock at night. He just spent his whole day in that park. Then he'd go and watch the kids training and, you know, and see what was coming through and things like that, you know what I mean? So
Football.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that brings us on to 2006, and he was announced as having an illness. And I think that the hard thing here must be that he seemed to overcome it at first. Would that be right?
It was actually 2005. He was diagnosed. He came in from training. He said, I have to go to Ross Hall. They took Jordan with him. And he said, about this mole, which he's had forever. He said, it's getting really itchy. He said, and the doctor dealt it. He says, you better go. So he went to Ross Hall and he took Jordan with him. And they took it out. And then the following, I don't know what day that was, but the following Thursday, we had to go to the Nuffield. So him and I went up to the Nuffield, and obviously for the results, and they said to him he'd malignant melanoma. Now, see, to be honest with you, I wasn't even upset. I actually thought, it's a mole, you know, you'll cut that out, and that's that, we'll stitch that up, and that's absolutely fine. So our Emma was getting married the following year in 2006. So we came in and he told him, and oh, they're all crying and all that and whatever, and then he says it's absolutely fine. And then in the March of the following year, 2006, mm-hmm, he took really bad and he had to go in to the Royal. He went in and he was in there for quite a while, and obviously, I don't know, I think the press had noticed that he wasn't in the dugout. And they were putting two and two together.
Mm.
So I think Peter Lowell phoned him at the hospital. He says, look, Tam, he says, they're asking questions here. He says, we're going to need to tell them something. He said, so Thomas says, just say, aye, that's absolutely fine. And he got over that. And Emma got married in the May. He got over that. That was 2006. 2007, I remember the November. And he was sitting up, rocking at the side of the bed. And I said, are you okay? So, really pains and whatever. So, but he was going to see the oncologist the next day. And I said, mind tell her about your whatever. And he says, I will. So she put it down to anxiety. So that was then. The 14th of February, he went in for the camera. And they told me to come back, phone and see when he was ready to go out. So I phoned. And they said, yeah, he can come down and get him. He said, but he's got to eat and pass water before he gets out.
Mm-hmm.
So I went down to get him. And by that time, the doctor hadn't come back with any results. So when I went down to get him, the doctor had been, and he was kind of just sitting. I said, what's wrong? And he says, I think the cancer's back. Mm-hmm. So that was the 14th. We went the 21st up to the Beatson. That was the day our Cole was born. My first grandson was born that day. That morning, and Emma's texts me and saying, "Mum, going to bring me up Bibs. He keeps me sick. I thought, I'm not going up to visit her." So, and she wondered why. But anyway, so we went up to the Beatson, and that was fine. And she came in and she says, "Well, I hear you've had good news today." And he said, "Yeah." He says, "We're delighted." She said, "Well, I'm sorry, I don't have good news for you now." She said, "It's full blown in your stomach and it's into your liver." So he said to her then, he says, "How long have I got?" And she said, "I don't think you need to know that today. I think you've been told enough today." So back the following week, but by this time he'd his head on, he was thinking, "No," he said, "I'll go abroad, I'll do whatever, you know what I mean?" He said, "I'm not going to sit here and no do anything about it." So the club were great. They said they would prefer it. We never had to. We never got any treatment. So that was that. But yeah, so basically within February, when it took really bad, and he was dead to me. You know what I mean?
So that quick?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, David Proven, at the time, some told me up is three things in his life: was faith, family, and football, and that football came a poor third behind the faith and the football.
Oh, I would say it was faith, football, and family. Let me tell you.
He
did. I mean, that was another thing that he did say. Obviously, when the news time had come, that he regretted not spending more time with the family. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So it's one of the things you can never foresee. You know what I mean? So
you never know.
We didn't know any different anyway.
And it was a man of great faith. Did that help him at that time?
Oh, definitely. Without a doubt. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. And never faltered. Never, why me? Well, why know me? Why somebody else know me? I mean, never, mm-hmm. never ever know that. Never left him.
And I know that the funeral was obviously a sad memory, but there was something typically Tommy about the three Rangers guys carrying the coffin with the three Celtic guys, because...
No, just two Rangers guys.
Two, was it McCoyston and Smith?
Uh-huh.
Sorry, I thought it was three. He did bridge the divide somehow between the other guys that I know were Rangers fans. Maybe a bad word to say about Tommy. There was that element of respect in the other side of the divide.
Yeah, I think it's a wee bit like Alan Cloyson, Ian Durant and things like that. We all know the Rangers men, you know what I mean? And Thomas was a Celtic man, but he didn't rub it in Rangers fans' noses or whatever, you know what I mean? It's just, that's what it was, and they appreciated that, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you are what you are. So that brings us on to the end, because I told you there's two stories I was going to tell you that you might not have heard before.
Right.
I'm not being born here, but while I'm talking to you, I would like you to hear them. The first one is a story Mick Conroy told me. 1978, Celtic get beat in a semi-final 3-2 with Rangers, and Tommy gets sent off, right? And the next day in the dressing room, Tommy and Mick were the last two guys there. Now, they're single men at the time, they don't get any family ever, so they're wondering what to do. And Mick Conroy says he was in a bad mood because his knee had all blown up, he'd get injured. And Tommy was in a bad mood because he'd get sent off and he felt he'd let everybody down. And Tommy says to Mick Conroy, "What are you doing today?" And he says, "Nothing." He says, "Why don't you come with me?" He said, "I'll guarantee you'll feel better at the end of it." And Mick Conroy said, "All right." So he says, we ended up in one of the, I think it was the Royal, where there was a sick kids ward. And Mick says, "I noticed as soon as I went in, he was his first name terms were the nurses." So this wasn't just a one-off visit, right? And he thought, he must come here quite a lot. So the kids were overjoyed, two Celtic players, especially we Celtic fans. They spent a couple of hours there, and he says it was humbling because a lot of them were no well. He says, "We're feeling sorry for ourselves for a stupid football game and there's kids suffering like that." So he says, "It put football in perspective." And on the way out, he says to Tommy, "How often do you go there?" And Tommy says, "Not very often." He says, "I knew he was lying." He says, "Because you don't get first name terms with nurses and doctors the way that he had." Mm-hmm. But he never ever mentioned it up to that point. Mm-hmm. And he says, that was the kind of man he was. He wasn't interested in publicity or TV cameras or the press. He was doing it out of the goodness of his heart.
No, I don't know that story.
So the second story is, and this is a personal one here, it was 1985, and the Knights of St Columba down in Renfrew were having this presentation for a cheque for a hospital, and I don't know how Tommy got involved, but Tommy came down today the photo shoot and present the nurses in the hospital with the cheque, was a really nice thing to do. And the old guys in the Knights had brought him crystal wine glasses as a thanks for doing it. and one of them dropped her wind glasses, and you could hear them all rattling in the pits. And Tommy thought this was hilarious, right? And he didn't want anything for it, but anyway, their agreement was that my dad would go up to Parkhead and hand new glasses in the front door at the next home game. So next home game, my dad is up. He didn't get through the front door in the days. There was a guy in there, you're lucky to let the players in. And handed it over. Tommy sent a nice letter back, and that was the end of it. 6 months later passes by. It's the last game of the season at Wolf Street. And my dad got in to pay the Celtic pools at Parkhead as the team was going on to the bus to go to Wolf Street. And I said to my dad, I said, look, there's the team. And the two of us ran across, and they're all going to the bus. And my dad shouts to Tommy, hey, Tommy, how's the crystal wine glasses? And Tommy looked to her, and he gave her a thumbs up, and he went, I'll be drinking champagne at the end of the night, mate. And he went on to the bus. And I went back and to my dad, and I says, he thinks that we can win this league. My dad says, well, I don't know. He says, obviously, Dundee needed us a wee favour, he says, but, you know, stranger things have happened. And that day, there was something in the air that day. It's really hard to describe it. You know, anybody who was there might not understand what I'm getting at here, but I think there's enough of us who experienced that day. There was definitely something in the air. And from that moment onwards, that Tommy says that he was going to drink the champagne that night, I the first time that I dared believe that we could win that league, and look what happened.
I know.
And for me, that's a wee special memory.
That was an amazing day, that.
So it was.
And at that time, there was no live television, you know what I mean? Live games on the television. That's so right. I'm listening to it on the radio. And I'm going, oh, I'm turning it down, and I'm turning it back up, and whatever. So it was I couldn't believe it myself, to be honest with you.
I know.
But it was just incredible. In fact, I was at a do not long ago. In fact, it was, I think it was the anniversary of that. I don't know if it was must have been 30 years. And Albert Kidd was invited along to it. Mm-hmm. What reception he got that night as well. Mm-hmm. So I think he lives in Australia now.
He does that. Uh-huh. That's right, that's right. So that brings us to the end, Rosemary. Just like you say, thanks very much for giving us your time, and that was a wonderful wee trip down memory lane, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, thank you.
Bring me sunshine in your smile.
I hope you enjoyed that podcast. As I always say at this time, there'll be more podcasts along soon, and I never give you a timetable as to when that soon's going to be. Talked earlier in the last podcast about some special guests coming up. Rosemary was the first of those that I knew about. There was another one which was supposed to be recorded on Tuesday, but due to the very busy schedule of the person I was meeting, it had to be rearranged. There'll be some fantastic exclusive gossip that's coming out in that podcast whenever ever it happens. Anyway, there will also be audio along from the game on Saturday against Ross County, and cross my heart, hope to die, I will have some more podcasts along in the coming weeks for those of you to pick up while you're on your mammoth school holidays. If you're a teacher, you know who you are. Anyway, hope you enjoyed that podcast with Anthony talking to Rosemary, and I will say that's enough of me. Good night, and God bless. Good night.
This world where we live, there should be more happiness. So much joy you can give to each brand new bright tomorrow. Make me happy through the years. Never bring me any tears. Let your arms be as warm as the sun from up above. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love. Bring me sunshine in your smile. Bring me laughter all the while. In this world where we live, there should be more happiness. So much joy you can give to each brand new bright tomorrow. Make me happy through the years. Never bring me any tears. Let your arms be as warm as the sun from up above. Bring me fun, bring me sunshine, bring me love.